venous thromboembolism in pregnancy. This is one of the most common causes of the maternal mortality. You should be knowing about the coagulation cascade. You should know that there are two pathways of bleeding and blood clotting, intrinsic pathway and the extrinsic pathway. Intrinsic pathway, it starts with injury to the blood vessel. So factor 12 is converted to factor 12A. It causes activation of factor 11 and factor 11 changes into factor 11A. This activates factor 9 and so it will change into activated. A stands for activated factor 9. So here two cofactors will come. These two cofactors are factor 8 and factor 2 in the presence of calcium ion. So these three are just for helping, okay? So they will come, they will convert inactive factor X, factor 10, to activated factor 10. So again, we will need another cofactor. Here the cofactor is going to be 5. 5 and activated 2. Activated 2 we got here in the previous step. So 5 and activated 2A, they are going to make factor 5A. They will convert prothrombin into thrombin. Okay, thrombin you know is factor 2. Prothrombin is factor 2 and that will be prothrombin, and when it is activated it will form for activated thrombin, and for this function we need calcium ions. So you can see these blood clotting factors, these 5 clotting factors, 6 clotting factors are required. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 clotting factors are required, and then 3 clotting factors like 2, 5 and 8. These are cofactors. Cofactors like mm-hmm. they are assisting the function of the main factors. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Here now this is the extrinsic pathway. Give us some scratch on the screen. On the skin, one unfortunately met some accident, so the tissue collagen was exposed. So this pathway will directly start. It will start with activation of factor 7, which will be changed to factor 7A, and then from this point onward, the rest of the complex is going to be the same. Again, factor X will change into activated X, 10 will change into activated factor. We need factor 5 and 2A for this activation, and we will also need prothrombin. And so we are going to form the thrombin clot. Thrombin clot is going to be unstable. It needs stabilization. For that, your blood clotting factor 1, fibrinogen will come into play. And fibrinogen will change into fibrin, which is going to stabilize the clot. And it is going to cross-link the fibrin. So, and we need factor Christmas factor or factor 13A to make it happen. Very important, this cascade is very simple. So I'll just go over this one, okay? So then you should know about a simple basic test. The activity of the intrinsic pathway, it may be assessed in a simple lab test called the partial thromboplastin time. Or more accurately, the activated partial thromboplastin time. I have seen this in the SBAs, okay? That which test you will use about the assessment for the assessment of the intrinsic pathway, that is going to be PTT. Then the activity of the extrinsic pathway, it may be assessed in the lab using a simple test which is known as the prothrombin time, PT. I should add it here.
Yes.
That is going to be PT. Under the stress of exam, many students, they forget this one also. Then what is the pathophysiology? Normal pregnancy, as we know, normal pregnancy is associated with an increase in factor 7, 8 and 10. And marked increase in the fibrinogen concentration. Then increased fibrinogen, it is going to alter negative surface charges on the erythrocytes, and it is going to form Rolex formation, and it is going to increase the ESR. These are the changes which take place in the pregnancy. And amount of factor S is going to decrease. Increased clotting factors, they are detectable from 12th week of pregnancy onwards. Factor 8 is elevated in the late pregnancy. Normal pregnancy is associated with decreased fibrinolysis, and it returns to the normal level within 1 hour of the delivery of the placenta. So, the decreased fibrinolysis lysis. Okay, fibrinolysis lysis is going to decrease in pectoralis. So it is associated with increased concentration of fibrin degradation products or the F-dimers. So that's why, you know, they are non-specific if you want to measure them. So in pregnancy, we have Werther's triad, that is, we are having, since the uterus is enlarging, right? So it is decreasing the blood speed of the blood flow. So it is relatively venous stresses, and then compression on the enlarging on the veins by the uterus. So it is, and then pregnancy itself is a hypercoagulable state, and the cells, they have increased. So all of these are going to increase the risk of deep venous thrombosis. Another SVA that most of the, like 80% of the DVT in pregnancy, they will occur in the left leg. Okay. So if, there are two types of assessment, subjective assessment and the objective assessment. Okay. Subjective assessment is going to be unreliable during pregnancy. Subjective is that how your patient is feeling during pregnancy, during now. Okay, so that is going to be non-specific, because most of the signs and symptoms in pregnancy are going to be non-specific. That is one thing. So then most of the DVTE will occur in the left side, because the uterus is rotated backwards, but mostly it is turning towards the left side. Okay, mostly will be in the left side.
Left side. Mm-hmm.
So then we have to carry out subjective clinical assessment of VTE, particularly that is unreliable. So we cannot rely on that. So we have to do objective testing by specific test. VTE is up to 10 times more common in the pregnancy as compared to the non-pregnant state. If we talk about the risk factors, these are increasing age, all of this has been taken from the Green Top guideline. Increasing age, that is more than 35, increasing parity, that is more than 4. And then operative delivery, surgical procedures such as ERPC, sterilization, then immobility, long haul flights, like the, if she's flying for more than 3 hours, and then prolonged labor. Prolonged labor when it is staying like for more than 11 hours for the primary, more than for the multi, and more than 15 hours for the primary. Obesity when the BMI is more than 30, and if the chance of VTE will increase if your patient has history of VTE. Then if she has like the sickle cell disease, if she has white ethnicity, if she has thrombophilia, dehydration like hyperemesis gravidarum, and then in cases of ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. Then if she has excessive blood loss, hemorrhage of any cause, it is like even in background of placenta previa, still it is going to increase the risk of clot formation, malignancy, then blood group O, okay, and then in association with medical disorders like congestive heart failure, nephrotic syndrome, polycythemia, and also in cases of essential thrombocythemia, when they have like too much polycythemia, preeclampsia, then inflammatory disorders like the IBD, inflammatory bowel disorders like that, okay. Then even in the infections, that's why if you are admitting your patient during in the hospital stay, the chance will increase, because the risk of thrombophilia will increase if you are admitting the patient for more than 3 days. So in the thrombophilia, you know that they can be of two types, acquired and the inherited. So these are like, what is a thrombophilia? This is a state of hypercoagulable condition associated with increased rate of blood clotting. Can be inherited, like the antithrombin 3 deficiency, protein C deficiency, protein S deficiency. These are inherited ones.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then deficiency of the naturally occurring anticoagulants, like antithrombin 3 deficiency, it carries particularly high thrombotic risk. So if we are like in the highest risk will be with the factor 5 mutation, but the more common one will be antithrombin 3 deficiency. Okay. Because antithrombin, as the name tells you, that your patient is going to have, there is deficiency of this factor which is inhibiting coagulation. So naturally your patient is going to get these problems. Okay, more and more problems will come up like that. Then the acquired one. Among the acquired...
Sorry, could you repeat the last bit?
Yeah, I was saying that deficiency of antithrombin 3, what will happen? Antithrombin. Mm-hmm. So antithrombin is lost, so now there is nothing to oppose the thrombus formation. So that's why your patient will form the clot. That is the point, okay? Antithrombin is deficient, like antifreeze is less in your car, so there will be crystal formation. Just like that, if the antithrombin is deficient, then you are going to get blood clotting in the on the leg veins. Then activated protein C resistance. This protein C is going to keep the blood thin. So, but if there is resistance to this protein C, then again it will make some, you know, the some the patient will be more thrown to the this formation, clot formation. So the common cause of APC, activated protein C resistance, is factor 5 leading mutation. It can be like, there can be like single point mutation in the factor 5 gene. So this is seen like in 20 to 60% of the women in the BTE in the pregnancy. If they ask you which one is the most commonly acquired thrombophilia in the pregnancy, most commonly diagnosed thrombophilia in pregnancy, you will say factor five leading mutation, like that. Okay. Then prevalence of mutation is 3 to 5% in the UK and 6 to 8 fold increase in the risk with the heterozygous. And the guideline says that if there is mutation like heterozygous, then the chance of increasing this blood clotting is going to be, on average they say 5%, but it is 6 to 8%. But if there
is, it's what, sorry,
five times higher risk if you will see this heterozygous mutation, okay? Heterozygous mutation, 5 times increased risk. But if you will see homozygous mutation, the guideline says 35 fold increased risk, but some books say that 30 to 140 times increased risk of BTK. Then pregnancy and the use of the COCPs is also associated with increased risk of clotting. Then prothrombin gene mutation can occur, and it is responsible for 3 to 5 fold increase in the risk of risk in the heterozygotes. Then hyperhomocysteinemia, this is a minor cause, but if it will occur in association with other causes, then the risk will increase. Hyperhomocysteinemia, it is going to result from the gene mutations. And like it can occur in parts of deficiency of vitamin B6, B12 deficiency, folate deficiency, failure to the use of the anti-folate drug, failure and the use of the drug anti-folate drugs. So, but this is a minor cause, okay? So, then we should talk about the acquired thrombophilias. Or of everything I told you so far, that was about the inherited disorders. Sometimes they can ask you in the SPAs which one are the inherited thrombophilia, which one are the acquired thrombophilia. The acquired thrombophilia, anti-phospholipid antibody syndrome, and the presence of the lupus anticoagulant or the anticardiolipin antibodies of medium to high titer on 2 occasions 8 weeks apart in association with history of thrombosis or adverse pregnancy outcome. Then you know the definition of antiphospholipid syndrome, that there should be 3 recurrent first trimester miscarriages, 1 to 10, less than 10 weeks, and then the preterm delivery where the patient is delivering before 35 weeks of pregnancy, either due to severe PET or IUGR. The risk of VTE in association in women with the APS is more than 70%. Okay, so that's why we have to give them dual therapy, antiplatelet and the VTE prophylaxis. And it can be like primary the antiphospholipid syndrome. It can occur as a primary event, or it can occur in association as a secondary event in association with other problems. Like most commonly, it is associated with systemic lupus erythematosus. So when this condition is occurring, we are going to have the maternal risks and we are going to have the fetal risk. So as long as the clot is into the circulation, that is still fine. Okay? But once it will detach, then your patient is going to have, then it will give rise to embolus. This embolus will go to the circulation and it can go into the lungs and it can cut off the circulation and oxygenation, and it can result in instant death. Then even if patient has developed VTE, we have treated that, she is at risk of post-phlebotic limb syndrome, which can occur like up to 2 years after this condition, after this acute event. There will be skinning, swelling in the skin, ulceration secondary to the destruction of the venous valves. So skin is going to be shiny, hairless skin is going to be there. And risk is associated with anticoagulation. Then there can be fetal risk. Like in the fetal risk, obviously if the placenta is having these blood clots, so there can be first and second trimester losses can be there. There can be stillbirth, intrauterine growth restriction, and then there can be complications of anticoagulation. Like bleeding can be there, blood supply has been cut off, then so many problems can be there. So the assessment, how are we going to manage venous thromboembolism in pregnancy? Any pregnant woman with signs and symptoms suggestive of VTE, they should have objective testing performed. It should be done quickly, and even if there is a suspicion, we need to start the low molecular weight heparin until the diagnosis is excluded. So, or the treatment is contraindicated, like the patient is already having some bleeding or patient is sensitive to the VTE, to the heparin. Otherwise, unless you will just start the treatment with the suspicion, and you will continue it, okay? So what are the common symptoms and signs of VTE? DVT, the patient will have dull leg pain, calf pain, or discomfort, especially mostly on the left side, okay? There can be swelling, and there can be like lower abdominal pain, edema, there can be calf tenderness, there can be like induration, there can be pyrexia, low-grade pyrexia, and tachycardia. If your patient is having, these are the signs and symptoms of DVT. If your patient has already pulmonary embolism, dyspnea, collapse, she can have periodic chest pain, and like it will be pain along the chest wall, hemoptysis, and she can faint also. Why? Because she is not getting any oxygen. Then history should be identify other causes such as a trauma and infection, because it can occur on a background of all of these things. So there is a way of working up. This is also taken from the GTG. If you are suspecting pulmonary embolism, you should carry out clinical assessment. So the first test will be performed chest X-ray and ECG. You will do that. You are going to test the four blood counts, urea electrolytes, and the liver function test, and then you will have to commence low molecular weight heparin unless the treatment is contraindicated. Then assess objectively. Does this patient has signs and symptoms of DVT? If the signs and symptoms are there, you will perform compression duplex ultrasound. Okay, compression duplex ultrasound is reliable. So, if compression ultrasound confirms DVT, then we will continue therapeutic doses of the low molecular weight heparin. Then, if on the other hand, if the patient doesn't have signs and symptoms of DVT, then we will have to look at this one, that is the chest X-ray normal. This point is extremely important. Many students, they don't get it. Okay, just this compression duplex ultrasound was abnormal. Then again, we will see that we will see look at the chest X-ray. Here directly, the patient didn't have signs and symptoms, but we are suspecting that she has this VTE or she has developed this pulmonary embolism. So what are we going to do? Like patient has dizziness, hemoptysis, all symptoms of chest pain, then we are doing the chest X-ray. So you will see that chest X-ray is normal or not. Similarly, if the compression duplex compression ultrasound was not, it didn't confirm VTE, how you will know that this is DVT? Because what will happen, the blood flow will stop beyond that point and the blood vessel will be incompressible because the clot is blocking the blood vessel, okay? That's what you are going to see on ultrasound. So here, on ultrasound, DVT not confirmed, then again you will have to refer to the chest X-ray. So chest X-ray, there can be two outcomes. Chest X-ray is normal or abnormal, okay? If chest X-ray is normal, you should do VQ scan. Okay. Chest X-ray is normal, do ventilation perfusion scan, VQ scan. If chest X-ray is abnormal, you will do CT of the pulmonary NGO, CTPA, CT of the pulmonary artery. Very important point, because it will all depend upon the chest X-ray. So you did VQ scan and pulmonary embolism confirmed or it will not be confirmed, okay? So patient will have either, there are just two things. X-ray will, first X-ray will be normal or abnormal, okay? Second is normal X-ray, we did ventilation scan, okay? In pregnancy, we are not doing the perfusion scan. We are doing only the ventilation. We are just giving the helium gas. Pulmonary embolism has been confirmed or it will not be confirmed, okay? If pulmonary embolism has been confirmed, whether you did VQ scan or you did CTPA, there are two likely outcomes. Either PE is confirmed or it is rejected. It is not confirmed. If it is not confirmed and the clinical suspicion of the PE is low, we can discontinue low molecular weight heparin and consider alternative diagnosis. If the clinical suspicion of pulmonary embolism is high, consider alternative or repeat testing and continue low molecular weight heparin. Point to take home is that unless DVT has been or pulmonary embolism has been excluded, you are going to continue therapy. That is important, okay? Second outcome can be that PE has been confirmed. So if pulmonary embolism has been confirmed, you are going to continue therapeutic doses of low molecular weight heparin. And this patient is going to get daily reviews. That is the point, okay? So in the initial investigations...
So if she has suspicious, like if the findings of the VQ scan or the CTPA is negative, but she is still clinically
suspicion.
Do we continue on the do we continue on the
LMB,
the treatment dose?
You will continue on the treatment dose or therapeutic dose depending upon the weight of the patient, right? And you can have to offer alternate or repeat testing. Here the alternate testing, what will be the alternate testing? They will just go for further investigations. They will just repeat every test. And if still the suspicion is high, then they will have to go for surgery. You know that they can just do, they can do like interventional, they can do embolectomy or they can do simply thoracotomy. They can open the chest and they can remove this one. But these are mostly theoretical things because in practice, the things will move very fast. That is one point. Okay.
Okay.
So you requested CBC, you are going to see slightly elevated white blood cell counts, okay? So they may occur in infection as well as in VTE. So infection alone is also going to increase the risk of developing VTE. That is the point, okay? So in the ECG, you will have to do the pregnancy. So you are going to see, you will have to do the ECG in the pregnancy. You are going to find sinus tachycardia. That is the most common finding. Yes, then remember S1, Q3 and T3. There can be like, they are mostly absent, okay? S1, Q3 and T3, they are mostly absent. That is the point, okay? After that, you should go for ABG. Like there is going to be hypoxemia, hypocapnia and respiratory alkalosis. You know, this is not hypercapnia. That is hypocapnia.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
blood is, this blockade is affecting both. The gases are not going to the lungs and the oxygen is not coming to the circulation. That is the point, okay? Hypocapnia, hypoxemia, respiratory alkalosis. So these are characteristic of the pulmonary embolism. D-dimers are elevated in the normal pregnancy and the postpartum period. So we are not relying on them. However, if the level is low, it is going. This is just like for reassurance that if the level is low, so it means that patient is not having VTE.
VTE.
Then you have to carry out the baseline assessment before anticoagulation. So before starting the any treatment, you should have full blood counts. You should have urea and electrolytes, liver function test, clotting screens, coags should be ready. Okay. And routine thrombophilia screen is not recommended. Only if the patient has risk factors, only then you are going to do something for them. So in the exam, they can give you like the initial treatment, that what is the initial treatment, or they can give you like initial treatment, or they can tell you initial treatment, or they can give you someone who is already receiving treatment, and then they are asking you to change that treatment or like that, okay? So if you are clinically suspecting VTE, treatment is with the low molecular weight heparin and it should be given unless the diagnosis has been confirmed or excluded by diagnosis has been excluded. These are the words of the guideline. By objective testing, unless the treatment strongly contraindicated. No molecular weight heparin should be given daily in two divided doses. They are given subcutaneously. And why it is so? Because, you know, in pregnancy, the pharmacokinetics, they are going to change. Deltaparin and enoxaparin, their pharmacokinetics are changed. So we are going to use low molecular weight heparin subcutaneously, and then we are going to adjust the dose according to the booking weight or most recent weight. That is the point. So if we talk about the low molecular weight heparins, we are dealing with three things. We can use deltaparin, we can use tinzaparin or enoxaparin. Most commonly in pregnancy, like you are also using Clexane all the time, right? So that is actually enoxaparin.
Enoxaparin, yeah.
Yeah. So low molecular weight heparins, they are more effective, and they are associated with lower risk of hemorrhage and lower mortality rate than the unfractionated heparin in the initial treatment of DVT in the non-pregnant women. Low molecular weight heparins, they are effective as unfractionated heparin in the initial treatment of the pulmonary embolism. So both, you should remember, it's an important point that low molecular weight heparin and the unfractionated heparin, they both are going to cause the risk of thrombocytopenia, heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, and we also call it HIT, H-I-T, and osteoporosis. But the risk is lower if you are using enoxaparin as compared to the unfractionated heparin. So the rates of having this thrombocytopenia and the osteoporosis, they are 2% for both conditions, okay? But slightly less chance if you are giving low molecular weight heparin. IV unfractionated heparin is the preferred treatment in massive pulmonary embolism with cardiovascular compromise, because we need to remove the clot immediately. So in the emergency event, in the start, we are giving unfractionated heparin. Why? Because it has a short half-life, so the therapeutic drug levels, it is easier to manage. The low molecular weight heparin, it has very long half-life. So sometimes it can lead to bleeding, and it can be difficult to manage the levels, okay? So then the leg should be elevated. Thermoembolic detent stockings, they should be applied to reduce the edema, and mobilization should be encouraged as soon as your patient is able to do this, to be mobile, okay? If your patient is having in specific locations, like it is rare that they will have thrombus formation in the femoral ileum, mostly it can be in the femoral circulation, but if it is at a higher level, like at the iliac vessel, then we have the option to introduce inferior vena cava filters. These can be temporary, okay, and you will put, and then still you have to continue. They are like a sieve, okay? They are going to filter the clots in the lower part. They will keep them in the lower part, okay? So if your patient is having recurrent VTEs, then you are going to put Green's filter or permanent VT, venous thromboembolic filter, okay? Inferior vena cava filter. But sometimes, you know, there can be like a blockade of this filter also. So in those situations, you will have to remove them. So this is job of the vascular surgeons. So when we are giving this therapy, since this is like very complicated process, like patient can have many complications, so we have to be very careful. We know that it is going to affect the factor 10. Okay, it has anti-10 activity. So it is now, so routine measurement of the peak anti-XL activity level is not recommended. Okay, then you have to be careful in the women whose weight is like less than 50 kg and more than 90 kg. They will need additional monitoring. Or if they have VTE with other complicating factors such as the renal impairment or the recurrent venous thromboembolism, so they are going into the high risk group. If we have to, if the patient belongs to the higher risk group, and we have, then how we will know that what is the effective level of the VTE of this heparin? Peak anti factor 10 activated factor 10 level activity is seen 3 hours post-injection of the low molecular weight heparin, and according to guideline, it should be 0.5 to 1.2 units per ml. That is the level of the anti-X level. Okay. So then routine platelet counting monitoring, it should not be carried out unless your patient has received unfractionated heparin. If he has received unfractionated heparin, then we are going to check the platelet counts on alternate days or until the 14th day of the therapy, whichever will occur. Like he has completed 14 days of therapy, then you can stop. Or if you are taking, you can take on the alternate days, then also you have to continue till the day 14 of the administration of the treatment, okay? Or
so it's
every
a
other day, whichever
so
will occur.
Okay, 14 days, we need to do the platelet count.
14 days, but if you started, like, you know, in one patient, you started on day one, right? In one patient, you started on day two. If you are starting on day one, then the last test will be on day 13. Because 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, and 13, right? If you started on the day one, this is like a point to think. Like, patient came today, right? You started this therapy, unfractionated heparin today, right? So then day 13 will come before day 14, right? So on day 13, you will stop. Now another patient, you didn't start on day one. You started 24 hours after starting the treatment. So then you are going to continue till day 14. The point is, whichever is occurring earlier, you are going to stop on that one, okay? And this this condition is called HIT, heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, like that. So pregnant women who develop heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, or those who have heparin allergy and they require continuing anticoagulant treatment, then they have to be managed with the heparinoid, because you cannot leave the patient as she is. So we are going to give them heparinoids. Which are the heparinoids? Danapyrine, sodium or fondaparinux. Okay, and they have to be given by the specialist. So if they give you someone who has developed some complication, like he's allergic to the heparin, or she has developed this heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, then you will have to give them heparinoids, which will be like danapyrine, or it will be fondaparinux. But you will have to continue the therapy, but these drugs will be given by the consultant, like that, okay? Consultant hematologist, like that. Then in some cases we have to offer the objective testing. Like when you are suspecting deep venous thrombosis, you will have to do compression duplex ultrasound. If it is negative and there is low level of clinical sensation, anticoagulant treatment, it can be stopped. If ultrasound is negative but there is a high level of the clinical suspicion, then treatment should continue and the ultrasound repeated in 1 week, or an alternative diagnostic test, it should be employed. If repeat testing is negative, anticoagulation treatment should be stopped. You remember we did this algorithm in the start, like that, okay? So if
yes,
we
yeah.
said that first one is inconclusive, we will do repeat the testing, or we will carry out the alternative testing. And if that is meaningful, then we will continue the treatment. But if the repeat testing is negative, then you are going to stop it altogether. Okay? That is an important one. Pulmonary embolism. So the chance of having pulmonary embolism is very less. Some the RCOG strategy says that 3%, but the guideline says 5%. So they will give you 3 to 5, or they will give you less than 5%. Both are right. Okay. So you will do the chest X-ray. Like we said, the chest X-ray is normal. Then we will have to do the compression duplex ultrasound. Okay. So if both tests are negative, but the fear of having this VTE is high, then you will have to do the VQ scan, the ventilation perfusion scan, and or you will have to do a lung perfusion or a computed tomography angiogram, CTP, computed tomography, pulmonary angiogram, it should be performed. Alternative or repeat testing should be carried out when the investigations are normal, but the clinical suspicion of pulmonary embolism is high. And anticoagulant treatment has to be continued until pulmonary embolism is definitively excluded. CT pulmonary angiogram, it has better sensitivity and specificity, at least in the non-pregnant women, and a lower radiation dose to the fetus when compared to the VQ scan. CTPA, it is associated with...
Does it depend on the site? Does it depend on the site? Let's
yeah,
the
yeah.
clinical symptoms.
Yeah. Yeah,
like whether to continue the
yeah.
treatment or not, like
basically,
if she comes with
basically, you know, you have to rely on the chest x-ray. Chest x-ray is normal, do VQ. Chest x-ray abnormal, do CTPA. So that is your clinical judgment, okay? That is the point. So in the VQ, in the CTPA, the average radiation exposure for the child is less than 10%, okay? CTPA, it can identify other pathologies also, because this is angiogram. So if there is aortic dissection, like in cases of Marfan syndrome, it can also be diagnosed. But the main risk for the mother is that she can develop breast cancer. What is the chance? The chance is, if you will go there, it is chance will increase by 13%, okay? So that is significant. That is associated with CTPA. Then you should remember that you have given the iodinated agents, the thyroid function, they should also be checked in the neonate for the mother, okay? Then in the VQ scanning, it may be delayed because of the availability of the isotopes, because we are using tagged helium, okay? So CTPA and the VQ, they may not be ideal if there are small peripheral pulmonary embolism. If they are like centrally placed, then we are going to identify them very effectively. But if they are lying peripherally, then it is hard to diagnose them, okay? So the potential advantages of CTPA, and despite the potential advantages of the CTPA, many authorities, they continue to suggest that VQ scanning as the first line investigation in pregnancy, because it has high negative predictive value and substantially very low dose of the radiation to the pregnant breast tissue. So VQ is a preferred one. In pulmonary angiography, it carries the highest radiation exposure because it is directly going into the maternal chest lapel. So breast tissue is sensitive to the radiation exposure, so they are going to be at increased risk of the BT, of the breast cancer. Like the chance of the CT breast cancer, you know, one is like, this is also SBA question. So you will have to, when you are giving the, thinking about the CTPA, you know, sometimes in addition to the chest x-ray, you will have to use your common sense also, because if a woman already has a family history of breast cancer, then obviously we should go for VQ scan, okay? We should not increase her CT, had this radiation exposure. That is the point. One CT is going to give as much exposure as 500 x-rays. Just that is the problem, okay?
Okay.
So
could you repeat the last one you said? It comes as an SBA.
Yeah. This is the one I'm going to tell you, okay? So women who have suspected pulmonary embolism, they should be advised that the VQ scanning, it carries a slightly increased risk of childhood cancers compared with the CTPA. If you are giving them VQ scanning, then the chance of having childhood cancers is going to be 1 in 280,000. Like you have done 280,000 people are there, and the chance will increase by 1%. Okay? So they will give you exactly the same numbers. With the VQ, the chance of childhood cancers 1 in 280,000. And risk of childhood cancer with CTPA is going to be 1 in 1,000, right? Four times. So the risk is increasing four times roughly, right? Because if you will have like 250,000, we will multiply it with four, then we are going to get this number like that, okay? So roughly four times increased risk of childhood cancer when we are doing VQ scan. And the 13% increase, 30.6% increase lifetime risk of breast cancer when we are doing CTPA. And the background risk for the breast cancer is 1 in 200. So we will get additional 13.6% cases when in 100. So in 200, we will get like additional 26 cases of the breast cancer. So that's why, you know, the decision should be made by the senior. And when we are deciding, when we are suggesting that the CTP or VQ scanning should be done, a senior person should properly advise this woman. And ideally, we have to obtain informed consent before these tests are undertaken. These are the problems, okay? And when we had know that is for the testing, like you are finding, then we were doing the general testing like arterial blood gas. So like I said, that we are going to see hypoxemia, hypocapnia, and the respiratory alkalosis. And the ABG findings, they are not exclusive, and some variations can also be there, like hypercapnia can be there if it is like a pulmonary embolism is secondary to the circulatory collapse. Sometimes you can get normal oxygen levels, so you're not going to rely on them. That's why, you know, the findings on the test, they have to be matched with the findings on the with the clinical findings. That is the point. Okay, so the absence of the typical results, the ABG analysis, it doesn't exclude pulmonary embolism. This is just giving you the idea that how is the patient, but it is not giving you, it is not helping you in the decision making. That is the drawback. Okay, but ABG still we have to do. Then we have to, then how we should continue the further treatment, subsequent treatment of this woman. We will have to maintain therapeutic anticoagulation for at least 3 to 6 months and for at least 6 weeks after delivery. We need to teach the patient how she is going to self-inject herself and then how she should be disposing of the needle safely. This was in the previous guideline, the new guideline doesn't have it. Then once a woman thinks that she is in labor, we have to counsel her that she should stop injecting herself and she should come to the hospital. And then after the delivery, we can, if she is suitable, then we can give her we can resume the dose. If the patient is going to have like planned cesarean section or she is going to have the induction of labor, then the evening, like tomorrow she is going to have this induction of labor or cesarean section, then today she can get her dose. In the evening she will get her dose and then she will stop. And then we can start that next day, like that. Like, because you know, at least we have to give, like if she is on the prophylactic, then we are giving every 12 hours. But she is on the therapeutic dose, then we are going to start that after 24 hours, like that. And if you think that the risk of the hematologist thinks that the risk is higher, then we will have to give her unfractionated heparin. So that is the point. So then we have to remember that if the patient received the epidural dose, then we are not going to remove the catheter until 12 hours after the dose. And we should not give low molecular weight heparin until within 4 hours of removing the catheter. So it should be removed 12 hours after administering the last dose of the heparin, and the next dose should not be given within 4 hours of removing the catheter. That is the point. Okay, this point is very important for you. There is 2% risk of hematoma formation if cesarean section is done, and prophylactic low molecular weight heparin day before the surgery, and then prophylactic dose should be given 3 hours post-operatively or 4 hours after removal of the epidural cannula. Like this patient had GA, she was under GA, so we can resume the dose of heparin 3 hours after doing this procedure. And if she received epidural, then we are going to do it 4 hours after removal of the cannula. If patient is at significant, and then the therapeutic dose should be given that evening, and wound drains, and we are going to insert the drains and the sutures you are applying. If the patient is on VTE therapy, you are going to give interrupted sutures, so that otherwise patient can develop a seroma or there can be hematoma formation and 2% risk of having this complication. Then if the significant risk of hemorrhage, we are going to use unfractionated heparin, because unfractionated heparin has a short half-life, so that is beneficial. If your patient starts to bleed, we are going to give the reversal, and the reversal is going to be protamine sulfate. Postpartum women, they can be treated with either heparin or warfarin. Postpartum warfarin, it should be avoided at least at the third day and for longer in the woman at increased risk of postpartum hemorrhage. And then graduated elastic compression stockings, they should be worn on the affected leg for 2 years after the acute event. If swelling persists, then to reduce the risk of post-thrombotic syndrome. So she is going to use it for 2 years. All of these are SPAs. Post-natal review in obstetric medicine or combined OB hematology unit should be carried out. So assessment and management of them to be assessed at the booking and repeated if the patient is admitted like that. So anytime, you know, everything is carrying some significance. So here you should know that what are the risk factors, how we are going to talk about them. This information is important for you. So I put that in the middle. Like, you know, this amber means that is alert. Red means that very high risk. So we need to start the treatment. You are meeting the patient for the very first time. What actions you should be taking? Table given by the RCOG. That you know here, any previous VTE except a single event related to the major surgery. So it will require prophylaxis, and we are going to start low molecular weight heparin, and we need to refer her to the expert. That is one thing. Are you there? Okay.
Yes, I'm with you.
Okay,
yeah.
that's great. Then anytime.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It's just I closed the microphone because I was in the bus, and so I don't want all the noises to come to you.
Yeah, don't worry. You're going
okay.
to be good.
Yeah.
So hospital admission, previous single VTE related to the major surgery, or high risk thrombophilia, but high risk thrombophilia inherited, but no personal history of VTE. Then if he has medical comorbidities such as cancer, heart failure, active SLE, IBD or inflammatory polyarthropathy, nephrotic syndrome, type 1 diabetes with nephropathy, sickle cell disease, current IV drug user, or any surgical procedures done like appendicectomy, ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome, only in the first trimester, not in the second or the third trimester. So the risk is going to be intermediate. Okay.
Yes.
Risk is intermediate. So consider antenatal prophylaxis with low molecular weight heparin in the antenatal period. Now, if your patient has obesity, like the BMI is more than 30, age is more than 35, parity is more than 3, she is a smoker, she has gross varicose veins, and she has currently eclampsia. So out of these four risk factors are present at the time of treatment, you will start VTE prophylaxis in the first trimester. Okay, four risk factors in the start at the time of treatment to start VTE prophylaxis. Three risk factors are present in the second trimester, and you are going to start the prophylaxis from the 38th week of pregnancy.
Okay? Yes. Yeah.
Then regarding the other risk factors, some of the risk factors are here, but there are some other risk factors like you know, actually I think that all of these risk factors, parity more than 3, age more than 35, they are all going with this one, intermediate. That is the point. And no, these are associated with these other risk factors, okay? Only these are associated with the intermediate risk. These all others are with the four risk factors or the three risk factors present, then we have to start. Immobility, like the person is paraplegic, she has pelvic girdle pain, she has family history of unprovoked or estrogen provoked VTE in the first degree relative, or she has low risk thrombophilia, she has multiple pregnancy or IVF, or she has used assisted reproductive techniques. Then four factors are present, then you need to treat her. Four factors are present at booking, treat her. Three factors are present at 28 weeks, treat her. Green means very less risk. So the transient risk factors like dehydration, like it can occur in cases of hyperemesis gravidarum or current systemic infection, and the long distance travel. So fewer than three risk factors are present. So this is going to be a low risk. And then we have to tell her that she doesn't need any injections, any drugs. She should be just mobile, and she should avoid dehydration. That is the point. And then she's good to go. That is the point. So all of this, doctor, all of this is antenatal assessment, not the postnatal assessment. I want you to read this table several times, okay? So postnatal assessment and management, it has to be assessed on the delivery schedule. If there is any previous VTE or anyone requiring antenatal low molecular weight heparin, high risk thrombophilia or low risk thrombophilia, and there is low risk thrombophilia but with additional history of family history. So these are like they are coming into the moderate risk, high risk. So we are, this is the high risk, okay? High risk, so we need to start low microbiota heparin, and we are going to start for at least 6 weeks. You know, here at this point, I want you to pay attention to this one. She has low risk thrombophilia, but she has history, family history also. So for this patient, you are going to use you are going to class her as a high risk group. Okay.
So because of low risk thrombophilia, we are giving her 3. Yeah, and then with the family history, she's having 1.
Yeah.
So it will be 4.
Yeah, it will be 4. That is the point. Okay, so that point is very important. Okay, so that's why we will have to give her thrombophilia for 6 weeks. That is the point. If she has previous VTE or she has like she required antenatal low microbiota heparin, then postnatal also 6 weeks. She had high risk thrombophilia or she has some low risk thrombophilia, but family history is positive, then you have to give her low microbiota heparin. Then the intermediate risk, like if she has cesarean section in labor, BMI is more than 40, and the readmission and or the prolonged admission, that is she is staying in on hospital for more than 3 days in the perperium, that any surgical procedures in the perperium except immediate repair of the perineum, then the medical comorbidities such as the cancer, heart failure, active SLE, IBD or inflammatory polyarthropathy, nephrotic syndrome, type 1 diabetes with nephropathy, sickle cell disease, and the current IV drug user. All of these are going to be intermediate risks, and at least 10 days postnatal low molecular weight heparin therapy for prophylaxis. If risk factor persists, then we have to consider prolonging low molecular weight heparin. So the patient is giving for 10 days, but if the risk factors are staying there, in that case, we will have to give it for how many days? You will have to give it for additional days. Okay, so the hematologist is going to help you here. Okay, and then now in the remember we are talking about the postnatal thromboprophylaxis. Okay,
yeah,
age is more than 35, obesity like BMI is more than 30, parity is more than 3. She has selective cesarean section, and then she has family history of VTE or low risk thrombophilia. And 2 or more risk factors are present, then we are going to give them thromboprophylaxis for 10 days, okay? And again, you will have to assess her. Like if the risk factors, they will persist, then you will have to give it for more days like that, okay? Now, rest of these factors, they all carry like 1 point for each, okay? If the patient has gross varicose veins, she's running current systematic infection, then she is immobile like paraplegic, she has pelvic girdle pain, she has long distance travel, or she has current preeclampsia, or she has multiple pregnancy, preterm delivery in this pregnancy, like preterm means at less than 37, it is not like 34, okay? Still birth in this pregnancy, mid cavity rotational or the operative delivery, prolonged labor, like it continued for more than 24 hours, there was PPH, she has lost more than 1 liter blood or she required blood transfusion. So you are going to cause the factors, any 2 are positive, you need to start VTE prophylaxis for 10 days, okay? Then if the age is more than 35, obesity like BMI more than 30, parity more than 3, she's a smoker, she had lactose CS, and then she has family history of the VTE, and very good current infections, immobility, therapy, classic, delivery, all of these factors, PPA.
So when we say low risk thrombophilia, what do we mean by that? Sometimes they low say risk low
thrombophilia,
risk.
Like if by on itself it will not do anything. But you will have to combine like she has family history and she has low risk. Low risk, I will say that hypercystinemia, okay, then because this patient is going to have the folate deficiency, protein S deficiency, so these will be low risk anemias, low risk thrombophilias, like so you will not have to do anything like that. Basically, the highest risk this factor 5 latent mutation, and then you know this entire thrombin 3 deficiency, that is that these are the most high risk 2 thrombophilias. then prothrombin gene mutation, okay? And rest of them, they are low risk. That is the point, okay?
Yeah.
So then if you will go to the appendices, then in the end of the guideline, they have told you that antenatal and the postnatal prophylactic dose of bromanoprovate heparin. As mostly they are not asking, but sometimes they will ask you questions like this. So if the weight is less than 50 kg, the dose of enoxaparin should be 20 milligrams, and dose of deltaparin should be 2,500, and the dose of timsaparin should be 3,500 units daily. If the weight is between 50 to 90 kg, she should be getting 40 mg enoxaparin, 5,000 units of deltaparin, and 4,500 units finsaparin. If the weight is between 91 to 130, then enoxaparin 60 mg, 7,500 units, and 7,000 units finsaparin daily. If the weight is 131 to 170 kg, then we have to give her 80 milligram enoxaparin, 10,000 units of the deltaparin, and 9,000 units of the timsaparin. If weight is more than 170 kg, then we have to give more than 170, then you will give this BD profile at a dose of 0.6 milligrams per kg per day, and enoxaparin 75 units per kg per day deltaparin, and 75 units per kg per day timsaparin. If you can remember good, because very rarely I have seen this question, like 2-3 times, but I have seen that on the exam.
Okay.
This assessment of the venous thromboembolism, essentially all these appendices are just revising whatever we have learned from the previous one. If total score is more than 4, then you have to start the VT prophylaxis antenatally and consider thromboprophylaxis from the first trimester. Score is 3 antenatally, consider thromboprophylaxis from 28 weeks. If score is more than 2, then you don't give thromboprophylaxis for at least 10 days. From hospital antenatally, consider thromboprophylaxis. For long admission, like more than 3 days or readmission to the hospital within the perineum, then you will consider thromboprophylaxis. For patients with identifiable risk of bleeding, the balance of the risk of bleeding and thrombosis, it should be discussed with the consultant in consultation with the hematologist, and then we should give her the treatment like that. So when we are talking about the scores, these scores are important for you. Okay? Previous VTE has occurred, so that is going to be like the most high risk person. Okay. So if it is a score of 4. It carries a score of 4, that is the point, okay? Then previous VTE, which was provoked by major surgery, still high risk, 3. Known high risk thrombophilia, 3. Medical comorbidities also carrying 3. All medical comorbidities, they are covered here, okay? Like the SLE, autoimmune disorders, type 1 diabetes, IV drug users, also high risk, 3, okay? Sickle cell anemia, also 3. You can see here thalassemia is not considered here, but the sicklers, they are going to get it throughout pregnancy. And interestingly, I don't know why they didn't mention thalassemia here, because if you recall, thalassemics are also getting VTE prophylaxis throughout pregnancy, but they didn't mention. Then family history of unprovoked, 1. And best of the things, like we are repeating again and again, 35 plus, obese, BMI more than 30, more peritoneal more than 3, because you know all the same things. They have like one score is 1 for everyone. Multiple pregnancies still score 1, but the score will be 2 if your patient has like intrapartum cesarean section. Second stage cesarean section, again the risk is going to be, you can see here, okay. And then all
yes,
other factors, again, they are carrying the scale, the risk 1. If then there are certain transient risk factors, like any surgical procedure in the pregnancy or the perineum, except if the appendectomy was done, repair of the perineum, or postpartum sterilization, they will carry the score 1. But any major surgery, anything, it is going to carry a score of 3. That is also an important point like that, okay? Then,
so any surgical procedure, is
except perineal surgery, appendicectomy, and the postpartum sterilization. Okay. Any other surgery, give them a score 3. can be cardiac surgery, can be anything, but we will give assign a score 3. Hyperemesis 1, then ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome in the first trimester only, again it is going to carry the risk of 4. That is significant. Okay, why? Because it will cause intravascular dehydration. Then current systematic infection, again 1. Immobility, dehydration, 1. So if the known low risk thrombophilia is in a woman with a family history of VTE in a first degree relative, this point is very important in the MCQs. Students are always disagreeing with me, but you know the guideline has written very, very clearly. Patient has low risk thrombophilia, but the family history is positive. Then you are going to give them postpartum thromboprophylaxis for 6 weeks. Okay. Then another consideration, BMI is more than 30.
So why is it for 6 weeks? Because if because it's low risk thrombophilia.
Low risk, so, family history is positive. Family history
and
of thrombophilia.
Low risk thrombophilia is 1, yeah?
Yeah, but family
gives
history,
score 1.
Yeah, but family history,
and family history
score
of
2.
VTE.
Yeah, so it is
gives
already
2.
Score 3. Family history.
So, yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree
yeah.
with you.
Yeah.
So, when
so,
if we are starting at in the antenatal period, we need to continue for 6 weeks postpartum.
Yeah. But if but in this patient, she has low risk thrombophilia and there is high risk family history, then you will have to give her postpartum. Okay, I will highlight this one. Then you will have to give postpartum, not antenatal. Postpartum thromboprophylaxis. Did you get this point?
Yeah.
Postpartum. Postpartum thromboprophylaxis. Then you will have to give for 6 weeks. Another interesting
but
thing
then,
here is
in the antenatal period, does she need? She
no,
doesn't need.
No, not in the antenatal. You are going to give that in the postnatal period. That is the thing.
So antenatally, how much is she scoring? She is scoring 2 or 3?
Yeah, antenatal, just she will be scoring 2. So we are not going to
start
because if even if she will score 3, we will have to give. That is the thing. Okay. Then
but then I. if she is not scoring, like if she is not having in the antenatal period,
but
do
still
we
you
still
can
continue?
Give, yeah, still you can
okay.
give, no problem.
Okay.
You know, don't assume that all of the guidelines are highly appreciated. This is one of the most controversial guidelines. You know that, right? Always they are criticizing this guideline. One of the most controversials. That is the thing, okay? So
okay.
Then another interesting thing. If the BMI is more than 30, we are assigning a score 1. If BMI is more than 40, you will give a score 2. So read the question very carefully, that what is the BMI of the patient. More than 40,
yeah.
automatically you will give a score 2, so it will increase the risk, okay? That is the thing. So then what are the, obviously you should know about the contraindications to the low molecular weight heparin use. So if the patient already has a known bleeding disorder like hemophilia, von Willebrand's disease, or acquired coagulopathy, or she has active antenatal or the postpartum bleeding, then women considered at increased risk of major hemorrhage like the one who had placentophilia, then thrombocytopenia when the platelet count is less than 75,000, then acute stroke in the last 4 weeks, like he had hemorrhage or she had ischemia. Say
so these are all
disease,
the contraindications.
So here, you know, I will tell you an interesting thing about this also. Okay, severe renal disease like the GFR is less than 30, then severe liver disease like the prothrombin time is above the normal range or known varices. Then uncontrolled hypertension, like the blood pressure is more than 200 or the system diastolic. This is systolic more than 200 and diastolic more than 120. That is all. So all of these are contraindications for giving her PTE, low molecular weight heparin use. So in such patients, the hematologist is going to review these patients and they will tell you that what should be done for them. Most of them, they can be treated with fondaparinol, which are heparinoid, right? So we can give them heparinoid preparations, but only on order of the hematologist like that. Okay? So So that is the thing, nothing else.
Yes.
So then again, in the postpartum period, for how long we need to continue the therapy. If the patient is at very high risk, like they were previous VTE or long-term oral anticoagulant therapy, or she has antithrombin 3 deficiency and antiphospholipid syndrome with previous VTE. So we will recommend antenatal high dose low molecular weight heparin and at least 6 weeks postnatal low molecular weight heparin or until switched back to the oral anticoagulant therapy. These women, they require specialist management by experts in hemostasis and the pregnancy. So the expert opinion is required here. That is very important, like that. Then the high risk. This one is very high risk, okay? And the high risk group, any previous VTE except a single VTE related to the major surgery. So these patients, they will have antenatal, and they will, because the previous history of personal history of VTE, right? So she will take antenatal, yeah. 6 months antenatal, and then 6 weeks, 6 weeks postnatal. Intermediate risk, like asymptomatic high risk thrombophilia, like homozygous factor V leading compound heterozygous protein C or S deficiency, single previous VTE associated with major surgery without thrombophilia, family history or other risk factors. Then we are going to refer them to the local expert. They are going to give postnatal prophylaxis with low molecular weight heparin for 6 weeks, and then we have to consider that, like in this group, like the single previous VTE, we have to consider antenatal, but not routinely. So you will have to see, because of things they will change. Okay, if she has like 3 risk factors, you will have to start antenatally, and then you will have to continue in the postnatal period also. So sometimes if like, but if four. If four risk factors are not present at the time of booking, then we will again review her at 28 weeks. And if she will have like four risk factors, you are going to give her prophylaxis, and you will continue that 6 weeks. And then in the low risk patients, like they have asymptomatic low risk thrombophilia, like prothrombin gene mutation or factor V leading mutation, low risk, okay. Then we are, or they have hyperhomocysteinemia, we are going to consider as a risk factor and the score appropriately, and we, the thromboprophylaxis will be recommended for 10 days postpartum period, like that. Okay. Then what are the complications of heparin therapy? Thrombocytopenia, which is associated with paradoxical arterial and the venous thrombosis.
Yeah. Sorry, could you just go back to the So it says recommended 10 days if other risk factor postpartum, or 6 weeks if significant family history, yeah. postnatal prophylactic. Is it that's yeah. why you mentioned regarding the 6 weeks?
Yes, 6 weeks.
Okay.
So I want you to read this document at least 2 times now, and then every month before your exam, you are going to read it, because all the questions you are going to get in the, you know, the actual guideline is very lengthy, right? But I have tried to summarize with appendixes everything. I'm bringing in like 19 pages, but each line is just like answering one SVA question. Don't ignore any point here. Okay? That is the point.
Okay.
So complications of the thrombin. Go on.
It's just because I'm in the train station and my charging is showing it's red. It might just
go off. Go
my on. Phone might just go off any minute.
Complications of heparin are thrombocytopenia associated with paradoxical arterial and the venous thrombosis, and the low risk with the low molecular weight heparin, there can be bleeding and there can be osteoporosis, but low risk with the low molecular weight heparin. And complications of the warfarin, like there can be, if patient has been taking warfarin throughout in the first semester of the pregnancy, first trimester of pregnancy, then there can be fetal warfarin syndrome, like warfarin embryopathy. That is a condition which is associated with, you know, there can be hyperplasia of the nasal bridge, there can be laryngomalacia, there can be pectus carinatum, congenital heart defects, ventriculomegaly, agenesis of the corpus callosum. There can be stippled epiphyses, like there can be, we also call it chondrodysplasia punctata, and there can be teribrachydactyly, and then there can be growth restriction, there can be asyplenia syndrome. They can be diaphragmatic hernia because of the defective synthesis of the you know, bones and the muscles. And then there can be CNS anomalies like macrocephaly, optic atrophy due to repeated intracranial hemorrhage. And breastfeeding is not contraindicated when the patient is on heparin or warfarin, so you need to reassure her. And obstetric thrombophilaxis risk assessment should be done, and it should be managed accordingly. Another challenging condition according to the guideline can be cerebral venous thrombosis. This is a very challenging condition because it can present in multiple ways. Often it is unrecognized at an initial presentation, and large sinuses such as the superior sagittal sinus, they are more frequently involved, and the extensive collateral circulation within the cerebral venous system, it allows for a significant degree of compensation in the earlier stages of the thrombus formation. So your patient can be totally asymptomatic in the start. In the systematic inflammatory disorders and inherited conditions, it can, or in cases of the acquired coagulation disorders, although in up to 30%, no underlying cause can be identified. So this cerebral, this cerebral venous thrombosis, it can occur over a background of certain medical disorders, like I mentioned here, like that. Okay, COCPs, they are going to increase the risk. So these are additional risk factors, and the presentations they range from headache with papilledema to focal deficit, seizures, and coma. Dog says that MRI with venography is the investigation of choice. CT alone, it is going to miss a significant number of the cases. Intravenous heparin is the first line treatment, and local thrombolysis, it may be indicated in cases of deterioration despite adequate heparinization. So after that, when this acute stage is over, then they will have to continue therapy for 3 to 6 months. And the prognosis is generally good. High index of clinical suspicion has to be maintained at all the times. So that's all you need to know about VTE prophylaxis. In the acute condition, how you're going to manage it, I have combined 4 guidelines like the 37A and 37B. And I don't want you people to go back to the original guideline and read it, because the whole information has been given here, and it is going to save your time, and you are going to get multiple questions from here. So thank you very much for attending, and now you can go to your web page to answer the questions. Thank you. Bye bye.